On Mentors, Mice, and Men, Dr. John Hilditch. W. H. Auden once said, "A professor is one who talks in someone else's sleep." This translates, if a teacher has had a significant impact on your development, their teachings are coded in the deep recesses, sulci, of your brain forever. When I worked at the Flemington Park Community Health Center for my first clinical rotation as a resident in family medicine, John was the director. He had grown up in Wyarton, Ontario, and had matriculated from the local high school. He then came to Toronto to study medicine and intern at the Toronto East General Hospital. By the early 60s, he hung out his shingle near O'Connor and St. Clair Avenues in Toronto. Much loved by his patients, he did everything from delivering babies, doing house calls, and working ER at the hospital. He would often smoke a pipe during his shifts in the ER. One night, John nearly experienced the perils of firsthand smoking himself. He was smoking his pipe when he had to go into the minor operating room to suture a laceration. On this occasion, he first tapped out his pipe, put it in his lab coat pocket, and draped it on the nearest available object. He sat down and started to sew up the patient. About 15 minutes in, he smelled smoke. He looked over and realized that he hadn't completely put out his pipe. It had, in fact, been smoldering in his lab coat and the material had caught on fire. To his horror, he realized that that nearest available object was an oxygen tank. Fortunately, he was able to reach over, grab the coat, and put out the flame. In 1976, I was fortunate to have John as my mentor, and we became friends. When I was about to graduate, John offered me a job at the health center, and I was thrilled. But prior to starting, I had committed to two locums. It would be my first trips to both Bellacoola, British Columbia, and Bayvert, Newfoundland. I was to start back at Flemington the following January. During my first 2 months in Bellacoola, I realized I didn't know much. I was uneasy about going back to Flemington to start teaching. John and his family happened to be locuming in Hazelton, BC, that summer. Hazelton is a 2-hour plane ride from Bellacoola. I decided to fly up to see John and his wife Shelley and speak to them about my predicament. I had already signed a contract with the health center. I told John I felt I shouldn't go back to Toronto, but should stay out west and continue to get more work experience. He looked at me solemnly and he said, "As the medical director of Flemington, I must admit I'm pissed off. But as your friend, I think it's the best thing for you to do." I didn't return to Toronto and spent the next 6 years working in remote areas. John returned to Flemington. 4 years later, when I was in Bellacoola doing a locum for a colleague, I had heard that John and Shelley were in Port Simpson, just outside of Prince Rupert, BC. Port Simpson is isolated, but in the summer months it can be quite active. Several foreign trawlers fish near there to catch the salmon run. When the fishermen were sick, they would often radio to the clinic and get medical advice. I called up from Bellacoola and asked the nurse when Dr. Hilditch would be next in the clinic. She didn't know who I was and said he would be in later on in the afternoon. At 4:30 p.m., I called back and asked for Dr. Hilditch, using the best foreign accent I could. He came to the phone. I covered the mouthpiece so it sounded like the call was from far away.
"Dr. Hilditch,"
I mumbled.
"John Dubrow, fisherman out at sea. I have much pain and no urine."
John sounded concerned.
"How long have you had this for?"
And I said,
24 hours. Pain very bad. I puke one time."
John said,
"Tell me, Mr. Dubrow, have you had this before?" "Ah, yes, several times. The last time at Flemington Health Center in Toronto."
John immediately tweaked in and said,
"Okay, Follis, where are you?"
I laughed.
"I'm down the coast in Bellacoola doing a locum. I heard you were in the area. How are you and Shelley?"
And he said, "We're fine, you little shit. Cheers." He finished his career at Sunnybrook distinguishing himself in family medicine research, for which he received a lifetime achievement in 2010 from the College of Family Physicians of Canada.